Good morning and welcome to our worship service for January 8th, 2023. Welcome to the new year. We begin our worship service with the ringing of the church bell. Again, welcome to our worship service. Wanted to share some announcements with you. Our next Thursday night Bible study starts February 2nd at 7 p.m. in person and by Zoom. We're going to be watching episodes of the TV show The Chosen about the life of Jesus, and then examining different aspects of what it means to be called by Jesus. So if you are interested in participating, let me know. We are celebrating communion this morning, so if you are worshiping with us at home, I invite you to get a piece of bread and something to drink for each person who is worshiping. I also invite you to type into the comments the names of those who are worshiping with you, so that we just to give us an idea of who all is worshiping with us together today. Today is Dress Down Sunday, and we are collecting for the discretionary fund. After worship, we do a lot of different things all at once. We undecorate the church. We have some refreshments in the back, I hope, and we'll have Sunday school. And the Sunday school class is starting a new study on the 12 disciples and examining each of the different disciples. Women of the church have their planning meeting on Tuesday, and they are also collecting their world mission offering. See Dana for that. Wednesday is our congregational lunch at the Bread of Life at 11:30 a.m. Next Sunday is our joyful noise offering. Bring your loose change and drop it noisily into our metal buckets, and that goes to the emergency heating fund. Treasurers, turn in your financial reports to Cheryl next Sunday, and also turn in your registers and receipts for the financial review. Then coming up January 19th, the session has their session meeting. We're baking cakes for Meals on Wheels, and those cakes need to be here January 19th. Trustees have a meeting coming up on the 24th, and this is January, so we are starting to collect cans of soup to try and build a tall pyramid of soup cans for the food pantry. And also, we're going to continue collecting lotion for the bingo prizes for the nursing homes. Are there any other announcements? Okay. Let's see here. There we go. Let's prepare our hearts and minds to worship God as we listen to our meditation music. Thank you. Thank you, Cheryl. That was lovely. The true light, which enlightens everyone, has come into the world. To all who receive him, who believe in his name, he gives the power to become children of God. Our scripture lesson this morning comes from Acts chapter 10, verses 34 to 43. Listen now to the word of the Lord. Then Peter began to speak to them, "I truly understand that God shows no partiality. But in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name." The Lord always blesses the reading, the hearing of his holy word. Let us pray. O God, our Father, at the baptism of Jesus, you proclaimed him your beloved Son and anointed him with the Holy Spirit. Make all who are baptized into Christ faithful to their calling to be your daughters and sons, and empower us all with your Spirit, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And let's share God's peace with one another. Peace of Christ be with you and also with you. And let's see what's going on online. Okay, so we want to say good morning to Noreen and Jackie and Barry and Lindsay and Ben and Ann, Barry, and Nolan and Tessa and Reese and Roger and Faye and Yvonne, and Ken will be joining us later. Sandy is with us, Missy, so those are the ones that I can see online. We also have those listening on the telephone, and we want to welcome you. And even if you are joining us later in the day or even later in the week, please take an opportunity to type in your names in the comments there, and we want to welcome you to our worship as well. Let's join together in singing hymn number 156, The First Noel. We'll sing the first, second, and last verses. Please stand. You may be seated. So this morning, in the church calendar, we take a massive jump. We have just celebrated the birth of Jesus, and we are jumping 30 years past the one story in the Bible about his childhood when he was 12 years old and was in Jerusalem, all the way up to about when Jesus was 30 years old and started his earthly ministry. And so we start with the baptism of Jesus, and it is appropriate for us to remember our own baptisms at this time. In Deuteronomy 7:9, it says, "Know that the Lord your God is God, the faithful God, who keeps covenant and steadfast love with those who love God and keep God's commandments." Sisters and brothers in Christ, our baptism is the sign and seal of our cleansing from sin and of our being grafted into Christ. Through the birth, life, death, and resurrection of Christ, the power of sin was broken and God's kingdom entered our world. Through our baptism, we were made citizens of God's kingdom and freed from the bondage of sin. Let us celebrate that freedom and redemption through the renewal of the promises made at our baptism. I ask you, therefore, once again to reject sin, to profess your faith in Jesus Christ, and to confess the faith of the church, the faith in which we were baptized. Trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from the ways of sin and renounce evil and its power in the world? I do. Who is your Lord and Savior? Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. Will you be Christ's faithful disciple, obeying his word and showing his love? I will, with God's help. With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, eternal God, for you nourish and sustain all living things by the gift of water. In the waters of the Jordan, Jesus was baptized by John and anointed with your Spirit. By the baptism of his own death and resurrection, Christ set us free from sin and death and opened the way to eternal life. We thank you, O God, for the water of baptism. In it, we were buried with Christ in his death. From it, we were raised to share in his resurrection. And through it, we were reborn by the power of the Holy Spirit. Therefore, in joyful obedience to your Son, we celebrate our fellowship in him in faith. We pray that all who have passed through the waters of baptism may continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Savior. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory, now and forever. Defend, O Lord, your servants with your heavenly grace, that they may continue yours forever and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more until they come to your everlasting kingdom. Amen. Now, as we turn to a time of prayer, we're actually going to include our joys and our concerns in our prayer of blessing for communion. But right now, we'd like to share what those general joys and concerns are. We begin with the Church of the Week. And this week, we are praying for Christ Presbyterian Church and Interim Pastor Reverend William Hudson. Let us give thanks and pray for the members of the congregation, their elders, deacons, and pastor, that they may be encouraged and strengthened in their witness to the gospel. And one of the things that we have learned in recent months is just how many churches in our presbytery are without installed pastors right now. Christ Presbyterian Church is one of those churches. They have an interim pastor as they study and prepare to get ready to call a new pastor. So please keep them and all of the churches without installed pastors in your prayers. But keep Christ in Presbyterian Church in your prayers, especially this week. And let's see who's on our list. I put it right there. So on Monday, Sebastian Kapaki has a birthday. So Sab, we're celebrating your birthday. And Abel is on Tuesday, Abel Serrata. And Wednesday is Mike McHale. And then Thursday is Kelly Combs. Are there any other birthdays or anniversaries? Okay, let's sing and sign Happy Birthday, God Bless You. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you. So, again, we save specific concerns, especially for prayer after the public broadcast is over. So if you are worshiping with us at home and you have a prayer concern that you would like us to pray for, but you don't want to include it in the public comments, send us a Facebook message or text me, and we will include that in our prayers afterwards. If you have any general concerns or joys that you'd like to share right now, do we have joys? Yes, we're very glad to have Samara with us. Pat?
I wanted to thank everyone for the prayers through the last couple of months, through everything that I went through. Prayers were greatly appreciated, and I know prayer does work. So thank you.
And so thank you all for your prayers of support for Pat as she went through some different health issues. Yeah. Samara, do you go back to school?
The 17th.
The 17th, okay. Because Will's already heading back, yep. So pray for all of our college students as they head back to school.
It's all in the paper, but it seems like I'm saying all the great things that Will does about every other one, but he must be doing tremendously with the golf team and going well.
Okay, yeah, Will is doing well with the golf team, and we celebrate that as well. Any other joys? Okay. Any general concerns we want to share today? Prayers for California and their atmospheric river that's been deluging the state with water and wind. I know several people have either had tests performed or are getting ready to have tests performed, medical tests, so keep them in your prayers. And a lot of people are dealing with what the Fowler family would call the creeping crud, and just, you know, hacking and coughing and feeling bad. So we pray for all of them, for their healing as well. Okay. At this time, I will invite the little ones to come up and join us for our time together.
You guys want to come up? I sit on the front pew here? Okay, very good to have you with us today. Today I wanted to talk a little bit about names and what they mean.
And I want to show you a picture. Well, first of all, let me say, my first name is Graham, and my mom told me when I was a child that the word Graham means serious. And I don't think anybody who knows me would take that seriously. But my last name is Fowler, and Fowler is a bird hunter. Now, I'm not a bird hunter myself, but that's where our name came from. And our name is actually in the Bible. You have to look it up. It's in the Psalms. And there's an interesting warning about fowlers in the Bible. So check that out. But even though I'm not a bird hunter, Fowler has a special meaning for me. Fowler means that I am the son of Ken and Yvonne. Ken and Yvonne are my parents. My mom and my dad, and I am their son. And the name Fowler means I belong to them, whether they claim me or not. And I'm their son. They're my parents. It also means that I'm part of a family. I have a brother named Ian, and I've got aunts and uncles and nieces and nephews and cousins, and I have my own children, and Angela is my wife. So Fowler is the name of the family that I belong to. Today we talked about baptism. Baptism is a sign of how we belong to a family. We belong to the Christian family. Christian means a follower of Jesus. It means you look at the things Jesus said and the things Jesus did, and you pray to Jesus and you ask Jesus, how should I live like you? But Christian also means that God has claimed you as his child. You are his daughters and his son. He is your heavenly father. And in a way, that makes Jesus your brother. Isn't that interesting? And all these other Christians in the room here and all the other Christians in the world are your brothers and sisters. We are all part of one big family. And that is because God has claimed us as his children through Jesus Christ. And our baptism, and I believe you all have been baptized, baptism is a sign of what God has already done through Jesus Christ. So today we celebrate being one big family, Christians, followers of Jesus, and children of God. Would you pray with me? Dear Jesus, thank you for claiming me as your child. Help me live for you and love my brothers and sisters. Amen. Amen. All right. Thank you for our time together, guys. You can go back and sit down. And at this time, my dad, Ken Fowler, will read Psalm 53 for us.
A reading from Psalm 53, Denunciation of Godlessness. According to Mahalah, a maskil of David. Fools say in their hearts, there is no God. They are corrupt. They commit abominable acts. There is no one who does good. God looks down from heaven on mankind and sees if there are any who are wise, who seek after God. They have all fallen away. They are all alike perverse. There is no one who does good. No, no one. Have they no knowledge? those evildoers who eat up my people as if they eat bread and do not call upon God. There they shall be in great terror, in terror such as they have not been. For God shall scatter the bones of the ungodly. They will be put to shame, for God has rejected them. Oh, that deliverance of Israel would come from Zion, when God restores the fortunes of his people. Jacob will rejoice. Israel will be glad. A reading from Psalm 53.
Thank you, Dad. So there's a story about a shepherd who was a very devout Christian. He loved to carry his favorite Bible with him out into the fields and to read it while he was watching the sheep. But one day he lost his Bible and he searched all over the fields as best he could, and he could not find it. And he was really distraught at losing his favorite Bible. And then one day he was sitting there watching the sheep, and one of the sheep walked up to him with his Bible in his mouth. And he said, "What a miracle!" And the sheep said, "Well, I don't think it's that big a deal. Your name's on the cover." I don't think the shepherd quite realized what the true miracle was there, did he? I think that is also true in our scripture lesson this morning. This morning we read from Acts chapter 10. The passage that we read is Peter's sermon to Cornelius, a Gentile. And it's part of a much larger story that seems pretty miraculous. It starts with Cornelius, who is a Roman centurion. He is what is called a God-fearer. He believes in he hasn't converted to Judaism, but he does believe in the God of Abraham, and he prays to him, and he follows and obeys God's commands, especially caring for the poor. And he one day is visited by an angel. And the angel says to him, "God has heard your prayers. Send some men, go to Joppa, collect Peter." That's pretty miraculous, isn't it? An angel speaking to him. Well, at the same time that this is going on, Peter is in Joppa. He's at a friend's home. It's lunchtime. He's kind of hungry. He goes upstairs to take a nap before lunch, and he has this vision. And in this vision, this giant sheet filled with all sorts of creepy crawly creatures is lowered down in front of him, and he hears this voice say, "Kill and eat." And Peter says, "Oh, I can't do that. I've never eaten anything unclean." And God says, "Don't declare unclean what I have made clean." And this happens three times. And then when the vision is over, suddenly there's this knock at the door, and here are these people from Cornelius wanting to see Peter. That's pretty miraculous, isn't it? And so Peter agrees to go to visit Cornelius. He gets there. Cornelius has gathered his family and friends together, all the God-fearers he knows. And Peter starts preaching. And it seems like this is the first Gentile to hear the good news about Jesus Christ. Up until this point, the apostles have been preaching mainly to the Jews and some Samaritans. But this is the first Gentile, and it seems like this is, it couldn't happen to a better guy. As I said, Cornelius isn't a Jew, but he is a God-fearer. He has claimed faith in the God of Abraham. He has tried to live his life according to the principles of God, especially, again, caring for the poor. The Jews know him, and they trust him, and he is a blessing to them. So it seems like he is just the perfect person to be the first one to hear the good news about Jesus. In fact, when Peter starts preaching, he says, "In every nation, anyone who fears God and does what is right is acceptable to him." It sounds like Peter is saying, "You're a good man. God has chosen you because of all the good things that you have done." And yet, listen to the sermon that Peter preaches. He talks about how it is God who has decided to send a message of peace to his people, how we can live at peace with God. It is God who has chosen his son, Jesus Christ, to be the one to carry that message. At Jesus' baptism, it is God who poured out his Holy Spirit upon Jesus and gave him power. As Jesus traveled around proclaiming this message of peace, Jesus healed people and set them free from the things that bound them up and kept them from being able to enjoy the abundant life God wanted for them. And that is because God chose him to do this, and God empowered him to do it, and God was with him. And even when God's own people rejected Jesus, and he was nailed to the cross and died, God was the one who raised him back to life and revealed him to the apostles and gave them a message that Jesus has been chosen by God to judge the living and the dead. It is all God's work, all the way through. And at the end of his sermon, Peter says that anyone who trusts in Jesus Christ as their Savior receives forgiveness from sins. In other words, God is the one who chooses to forgive our sins and make us right with him through Jesus Christ, through all that God did in Jesus Christ. So this really isn't about how Cornelius was a good guy and deserved to be welcomed into the family of God, how his life was acceptable to God. It's all about how God has chosen to make us acceptable by setting us free from sin through Jesus Christ, and how God is the one who accepts us as his children. And God is the one who brings us into the family of God and gives us that promise of eternal life through Jesus. In other words, the real miracle in this story is not that an angel came and visited Cornelius, or that Peter had these visions that told him not to turn away from Cornelius. The real miracle in this story is the grace of God. That from the very beginning, God had a plan, and he revealed it through the prophets, that God would save us from our sins and restore us to a right life with him, that God would make us acceptable. That's an important thing for us to remember in our lives, because so often we might look back at our lives or at what we're doing now and think to ourselves, how could God love me? How could I make it to heaven with a life like this? We might be able to look back at things and say, I'm ashamed of that. And yet the good news is that God has already chosen to forgive us of all that and to make us acceptable through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And that is why we want to remember our baptism. For Presbyterians especially, baptism is a sign of how God has chosen us, not how we have made ourselves acceptable to God. Because think about it. When were most Presbyterians baptized? Not all of us, but most of us are baptized as babies. The baby hasn't had a chance to choose to live for God or choose to disobey God. The baby hasn't had a chance to choose God or turn away from God. Baby can't even talk. Why would we baptize babies if they have no ability to choose God at that point? Because we believe God has chosen them, that God has saved them through Jesus' death and resurrection, and that God claims them as his children. And so when we baptize them, it is a sign of how God is washing away their sins and accepting them, but it's also a seal. It is a promise that they are God's children, and God will never leave them nor forsake them. Of course, the problem is, if you've been baptized as a baby, you don't remember it, do you? And so sometimes throughout life, there are times where we begin to wonder, is that promise really true? Did God really save me in Jesus Christ? Am I really forgiven? Am I really God's child? And that's why we remember our baptism. We don't do it over and over again. One time, God lays his claim upon us. But at appropriate times throughout our lives, we remember how we were baptized. And we remember the claim that God made on our lives. So today we give thanks for the true miracle of God's grace in our lives. And today we recommit ourselves to celebrating that miracle and rejoicing in it by choosing to live our lives for God. Amen. Let us stand, and we'll sing our doxology and ask God's blessing on our offerings. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Let us pray. God of glory and strength, we share this offering with you as a response to your powerful acts in our own lives. We share our financial resources with you because of the wonderful ways that you have blessed us. Your majestic spirit fills our lives like the mighty waters fill the oceans. All glory is given to you, Lord God. In your powerful name we pray. Amen. And let's remain standing as we sing together the first and last verses of hymn 176, We Three Kings of Orient Are. And as we sing the hymn, I invite the elders to prepare to serve communion.
King and God and sacrifice.
The Lord Jesus invites all those who believe on his name to join him at the table, to eat the bread, to drink the cup, that we might be nourished by him for service to him. Let us pray. You are holy, O God of majesty, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, in whom you have revealed yourself, our light and our salvation. Baptized in Jordan's waters, Jesus took his place with sinners, and your voice proclaimed him your beloved. Your Spirit anointed him to bring good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, to restore sight to the blind, to free the oppressed. He lived among us in power and grace, touching broken lives with your healing peace. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of the bread and the cup, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, that we may be one with all who share this feast, united in ministry in every place. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. As Christ's body in the world, hear our prayers for those we name before you in the silence of this time. Keep us faithful in your service until Christ comes in final victory, and we shall feast with all your saints in the joy of your eternal realm. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, who also taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus gathered with his disciples for his final meal with them. He took the bread, he blessed it, and he broke it. He said, This is my body, broken for you. Eat of this in remembrance of me. In the same manner, after they'd eaten, he took the cup. He said, This cup is the new covenant, sealed in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. Drink of this in remembrance of me. For as often as we eat the bread and drink the cup, we remember Christ's death until he comes. If you are able to do so, and maybe it's not suitable to do so, I invite you to hold on to the bread until we can all partake of it together with our worshipers at home. And then we'll hold on to the cup until we can all partake of that with our worshipers at home. Also remember that we are a priesthood of believers, and so we serve one another. And so if you are passing the trays and you feel comfortable doing so, you can say to your neighbor, the body of Christ broken for you, or the blood of Christ shed for you. The body of Christ broken for you. Thanks be to God. the body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Thanks be to God. The blood of Christ shed for you. Thanks be to God.
Blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. Thanks be to God.
And if you would join me in the prayer of after communion, let's pray together. O God, you have so greatly loved us, long sought us, and mercifully redeemed us. Give us grace that in everything we may yield ourselves, our wills and our works, a continual thank offering to you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we are going to sing a new hymn. The words are, this is Jesus, and the tune is familiar, Come Thou Fount, and I invite you to stand.
Peace and Lord of all. Oh.
glory, here to rescue from the fall. Son of God, who comes to save us, Prince of Peace and Lord of all. For the heart so prone to wander, for these feet so quick to flee, God is here and love is reaching for the lost and least of these. This is Jesus, King of glory, here to rescue from the fall. Son of God, who comes to save us, Prince of Peace and Lord of all. You may be seated. And for our postlude music, Max Henry is going to play Star in the East. Thank you, Max, for sharing that with us. All right, so we've got a new month, new year. Let's go back to singing praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. So we have praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done. Got it? All right. Go ahead and stand. Wiggle your arms. Everybody ready? Praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done. I like this picture. It's a little fuzzy, sorry, but I guess a cousin in England caught a picture of the fox eating from the dog's food bowl in their backyard. So just thought I'd share that. And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit descend upon you all and be with you all, now and forevermore. Amen.